you were the hardest working, busiest Latino actor that I know. And probably beyond even that label Latino actor, just actor. Let's just say that. Jose Rosete.
What's up, Rocha?
How are you doing, man? It's always good, to see you.
How are you?
I'm doing really good, man. I'm really excited about this. I'm really glad that you agreed to do this. I know you normally don't do interview type things. I don't want to call this an interview. I want to call it a conversation between two friends.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
You know, if you don't mind, I want to, you wouldn't put this title on yourself, but I am. You were the hardest working, busiest Latino actor that I know. And probably beyond even that label Latino actor, just actor. Let's just say that. And I'm really excited, man, because just seeing what you have done from the beginning is incredible, you know. And I just want to say to people that they're like, who is this guy? In case you don't recognize him, you probably recognize him from the old darkroom movies. Man, I feel like you've never, unless as far as I know, you've never really, really spoken. You just let your film speak for you, you know, and your work speak for you. But I think that I feel like you shouldn't be the underrated, man. You are an amazing actor, man. For reals, from a friend to a friend, man to man. You've always impressed me, even back then when you were just starting, you know. And so I just feel like I just want to introduce you to a lot of people that probably don't know you.
Well, I appreciate that the kind words go a long way, man. Because in terms of our like history, like I was a fan of yours, of your, you know, music back in the days before I ever met you. So to think that one day I would work with, you know, you guys, Darkroom, Jose and Ed, and then stay friends all these years. And not, you know, I've supported you with, you know, like everything that you've been doing, and like I root for you, you know what I mean? So and you've always like checked in with me, and you've always you know, you like watch all my stuff, you know what I mean? So like it goes a long way, and coming from you, that like means a lot.
Yeah, man. No, I thank you. You know, I still remember years ago, back in the darkroom days, Jose and Ed, I think Jose maybe told me, he goes, hey man, he goes, we're gonna do this movie and we're gonna get this up and coming actor out of Arizona. So you are from Chandler, Arizona, right?
South Chandler, yeah.
Yeah. And I remember just meeting you for the first time, you know. And what's the very first thing what caught the bug, that make you say, man, I want to be an actor? What was it?
When I was a kid, you know, and I still do, but when I was a kid, I had a really bad stutter. And I mumbled a lot. So in terms of, like, that's why, like, I'm not fluent in Spanish, because I'm still working on my English, you know what I mean? So it's, you know, as a kid, it's tough when you have a stutter. And growing up, trying to, like, overcome that, it's, like, a huge challenge. And for whatever reason, like, around sixth grade, I'm watching a movie, and I'm going, man, I know that this is, you know, fake, it's like pretend, but they look like they're having a blast, and just the curiosity of what acting is and like what goes into that, just kind of it started for the first time like around sixth grade. And then as I got a little older, I would kind of do some research on it, you know, and just you know, continue to wonder. And one day, like, I heard someone say, Well, when you're an actor, you get to become another character. And like, I took that as I could put Jose away because he's kind of bugging me a little bit because of like, you know, how he talks. He's like really shy. You know, everyone thinks he's like stuck up because he's, you know, like, you know, I'm not a, like a very social person. You know, even the like interview thing, the like anxiety is there, you know what I mean? So yeah. it's just not my strength. So I thought, man, if I could put Jose away and become like another character, I'm kind of digging that. And I kind of like insist on it now, you know? Wow. So I took some classes and it just got to the point where, you know, if I'm playing this like fireman and he doesn't stutter, then like, I can't stutter. That camera turns on. I can't stutter.
Yeah.
You know, if I do, I'm going to make a, you know, complete, you know, ass out of myself. And it's just, it's not going to, you know, end well. So that challenge was like, man, that became my like dream.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I started to like ease my way into like, you know, background work and stuff like that. And like, it was terrifying. It was terrifying. But if it was easy, everyone would do it. You know what I mean? So, yeah. So I just got into like taking classes where it was more of like break the ice and like everybody would like quit. You know, because they would like make us get up in front of people and talk. Like when I was younger, I never raised my hand to like answer up.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like read out loud in like class was like my worst nightmare. You know what I mean? So talking to girls, man, was, you know, it was tough, you know, just social situations like across the board and like acting. In my personal life, I still struggle, but with the acting, Jose has to like go over there somewhere. And then I get to like play these characters.
And so. I see it. I've been there when the camera turns on and you're just like, boom, you know, and I'm just like, who's this guy? You know,
right.
And it's a beautiful thing to watch, man, to be honest with you. It is. So if I remember right, there was a military movie filming out in Arizona. That's a pretty big movie that everybody.
Three Kings.
George Clooney, Ice Cube, and Mark Wahlberg.
Yeah.
And I remember you were so excited. And then I was like, I didn't see you in it.
Because you blinked.
Yeah.
Like I told you, don't blink or you'll miss me, you know? So,
yeah.
Well, when I got like out of high school, I got involved in a film called Waiting to Exhale with Whitney Houston. And that was the first time where like I got a call because like I signed up with this 2-bit like agency thing, and they called me and said, hey, you know, like I didn't know what like background was or being like a extra was. I didn't know. So they said, hey, you know, it's like $70 for like, and like I was there for like 23 no no like I was there for like 18 hours.
Wow.
And I worked for like 40 minutes, and like I was about 18, and it was my first time like on a set where it was just, you know, a lot of downtime. It's not this big like, you know, glamorous thing.
Yeah.
It's a lot of like hurry up and wait. And then I started taking classes, and then Three Kings came along, and I was on that for like 3 months, you know, working almost every day for like 3 months, but like studying and like watching Clooney, Wahlberg, you know, Ice Cube.
So you were able to watch these greats.
Yeah.
If and that, you know, that in itself is worth sitting there.
Yeah. I mean, it's almost like it's a better class, you know, in terms of like observing and soaking up some game, you know what I mean? And because, you know, everyone messes up, you know, everyone has, you know, a great day. Some people have, you know, bad days, and there's egos and there's mood swings, and just because they're regular people too, you know what I mean? So watching that and just kind of going, okay, it's a priceless experience. And then I went to Texas for like 3 weeks, and I worked on Any Given Sunday.
Yeah.
And like I'm in a locker room with Al Pacino and Jamie Foxx and Jim Brown,
Cameron Diaz.
Her and just like a bunch of other people, like, you know, real ex football players. And then
dude, that's awesome. And that one showed your face. Because I remember that scene when the camera is following Cameron Diaz, and you're like her bodyguard or something.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah,
that was so cool, man. I remember being so impressed, you know, because I had never known anybody that had been in a movie like that, you know what I mean? And back then when we had met, you're just like, man, I'm a fan because I love Dark Room. And I'm just like, dude, you were in these great movies, you know? In case you don't know, in Three Kings, I know one scene was when they drive into that little village and there's a well and there's three guards. You're one of the guards.
I'm a well guard, yeah. When George Clooney has it was like the like rag and all that stuff, but like George Clooney has a flashback and then it like shows me, and that's where they go, oh, that's where the gold is, or you know,
so that's cool. And then what was the first Dark Room movie you did? I couldn't remember. Do you remember?
It was Drug Lords.
Okay.
I did two with you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Drug Lords. Okay. And
Drug Lords is the one where I get out of San Quentin and you and Raul are the homies or the brothers or something like that, right?
Yeah,
that was a lot of fun, even though I did horrible. You did great, but it was a lot.
No, man. You're like a lot better than you give yourself credit for. And you got to like, you know, I want to tell this like story too, but, you know, and I might like make some people, you know, trip out. But back then when we wrote letters, so I wrote like Jose and Ed a letter.
Not emails.
No, yeah, exactly. Like you know, no phones, no computers, but like I wrote them a letter because I had seen like Smile Now, Cry Later and like Dope Game One in the video stores, mm-hmm. Penitentiary Chances, you know, and I was like, wow, it's kind of cool because I used to, I used to dig the music and now they're making movies. And I thought, wow, you know, so I wrote them a letter and then it took a while and then I found, a couple years later, I found Ed's like email and then I sent him the email and then like they responded. And then one day Jose called me and I was like, wow, this is like unreal.
Man, this is Duke.
This is Duke. And I was like, dude, man, like it's crazy. And that phone call was crazy because I was like stuttering up a storm. I was like, you know, I was like scared, man. I was just like super like. Nervous, you know what I mean? But the opportunity that like they gave me was the first time where I think I realized, wow, I can like, you know, actually do this, because these guys could, you know, fly anyone in from Hollywood and they're giving like this dude from South Chandler a chance because I just reached out, you know. And I fly over there and I'm just sweating bullets, man. I'm like, man, you know, like I don't know if they're gonna like me, but I was ready to act.
Yeah.
But I was worried about when the camera wasn't on, you know, am I going to make like a fool out of myself? You know, am I going to say, you know, something dumb? Am I lame? Am I a nerd? You know what I mean? I don't know. So, and then I get there and it's like, it was like hanging out with friends that I grew up with. It was like this like smooth transition. And then like, I met you for the first time and I was like, on the outside, I'm trying to like look cool, but on the inside, I'm like geeking out, you know. And it was like surreal. But to your point, when we did those films, it was like get off the plane and start shooting. And you know, we like shot those things. I think I did 11 or 12 films overall with them, and we shot those in like 6 days, seven days.
I mean, when you're gonna film with Jose and Ed, you're gonna film.
You know, and it's no set schedule, and you know, everyone's also a part of the crew. I always like helped out with the wardrobe, you know, and made sure that you know certain, you know, what you're wearing is the right thing. And but like it was a lot of hard work, but it felt like family.
Yeah.
And like I don't know if I laughed that much when I would, you know, go out to like Hayward and just like hang out, and it was just like a big party of just jokes and like clowning on like each other. But like it was, you know, never work. It wasn't a job, you know what I mean? So it was fun, man.
It was they always had a great environment. It was a fun environment. You know, I think by the time we did that movie, we had already did a movie with Jesse Borrego from Blood In, Blood Out. We had already did a movie with Angel Aviles from and then I think you were the third actor that we got, and then we just kind of stuck with you, man. You know, we just liked your vibe, you know what I mean? So I know Jose and Ed have always cared about you. I don't talk to them now. I do miss them, you know, but I saw that you continued, you know, and I always wondered, was the darkroom movies what gave you that final push to say, I'm going to Hollywood, I'm going to do this thing, you know, or was it something else or just a combination of things?
Yeah, like I mentioned that there was a bit of like confirmation that I can do this, because what comes with acting is called being on location. So if, you know, to this day, you know, friends and family will like pull me aside and go, hey, so they actually like fly you out and they pay you. And I'm like, yeah, that's like how it works. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I'm not like, you know, like I can't pay for it. You know, I can now, but like back then, that's not, you know, some people do that. But I was like, yeah, no, you know, being on location is a big deal. And for any actor who lives outside of Hollywood, you know, in my case, you know, South Chandler, it's a pipe dream to think that like I could be a working actor and get flown out to like different places. But that networking and that like hustle like has to be there, you know. And I got flown out to like a bunch of different places. I went, you know, like overseas a couple times, you know, and it was, but I got to the point where I could, you know, I did like about as much as I could possibly do not being in Hollywood. And like, you know, I'm not getting like any younger, and like it was time to like make that move. But Jose and Ed flew me out like 9-10 times, and I was like, you know, I can do this, but it's time to, you know, make my way to LA.
Yeah. The last movie I did before my incarceration with you was Dope Game 2, where we played crooked cops.
Cops, yeah.
And that movie was hands down for me the funnest movie I'd ever done, because I finally got to play someone that wasn't a cholo.
You know, right.
I mean? And that was a lot of fun. And you know, again, I didn't take acting class. I didn't know what I was doing. I was just following what you were trying to do. What you were doing, I was trying to do, you know, but I had a lot of fun with that movie. I didn't realize that my time of freedom was coming to an end. It was a great experience. And I do want to, I have a question.
Sure.
Did you realize that I was involved in the stuff I was doing?
Yeah. Yeah, I think, I mean, in terms of being familiar with your music.
So it wasn't a surprise when the FBI came knocking on my door.
No, I don't. I think...
you never said nothing. You never, you know, you just...
You know, I don't know if you remember this, but during Dope Game 2, I spent the night at your house, like, twice.
Yeah.
And you took me through like Tracy and stuff, and yeah, no, I like, I had a feeling, like, I think one of the things that like I respected about you as like a rapper was that you did what you were talking about, where like 90% of rap is you know fabricated and you know, just like looking cool, or you know, so but you were like one of the guys who was like, no, he's like, he's rapping about what he did yesterday. You know what I mean? So it just like, it was pretty clear, but I also knew that consequences come with like that way of life. You know what I mean? Yeah. So
then what happened, you know, is for me, is all these movies that you did. And then I went away in 2004. And I kind of just dropped off the face of the planet, you know. The world kept going. My life was on pause. Ed and Jose visited me sporadically throughout the time. I'm not sure if I had any contact with you or communication or correspondence. I don't recall, but
I went with Jose once to see you, and then we talked briefly. I feel like you wrote me once or twice.
I think so. Yeah.
I think you did. I don't know if you remember this. And this is back in like MySpace, early Facebook.
Yeah.
But I remember you wrote me and you said, hey, I'm going to Phoenix to perform live. And you go, like, I want to ask you as a friend if I could invite you so you could kind of be there to like watch my back. Yeah. While I do this concert. And I said, yeah. And like 3 days later is when that happened to you.
Okay. Yeah. Cause I know I had gone out there. Yeah. There's so much that was happening, man. I don't know. Man. I was all over the place. So during those years that I was gone for 6 years, 2004 to 2010, you went to Hollywood, you went to LA. And by the time I got out, I looked you up. Matter of fact, no. By the time I got out, Jose and Ed invited me on set. Like, I was literally out. All of a sudden, I'm on a movie set when you guys are doing the Deliverance.
With Angel, yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah, yeah.
So I'm in prison. That's
2010.
I'm in prison. As you know, I changed my life. I became a Christian. I didn't want nothing to do with my music at all. But my friends were still my friends, you know what I mean? And that's why I remember reaching out immediately to Jose and Ed, some of the other guys that I rapped with in Dark Room. And they're like, man, we're in the middle. We're about to film a movie in Oakland, San Francisco. And I actually went on set to San Francisco first in some alley or something. I don't remember what scene it was. And then I went to their house where your arm rips or something like that in the special effects or
that's right okay
yeah. And I was there that night, and that's when I was able to see you and Angel Aviles, the one from Mi Vida Loca.
And you came with us for lunch in Chinatown.
Yeah, okay, that's right. So it wasn't filming, we went to lunch. Yes, we all
I saw you like a couple of days on set, and then once we wrapped we all went to lunch.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So here I am in prison. All of a sudden, I'm on a movie set, and I had a feeling that Jose and Ed thought I was just gonna kind of fall back in line. And I'm still pastoring a church now, you know. But I've got to say this is that you, even though I didn't come back as Sir Dino, I didn't come back as that, you have always talked to me the same way. You know, and I appreciate that. And that's why I continue to reach out to you. I continue to just support everything you do. So you had, I remember at that time you had a reel and all these different clips of these movies. And I don't know if all of them ever released or not, but it was an amazing clips because you're just like, you have braids on one movie, you have an afro on another. It was just crazy, you know.
Like I think the perks of being an actor in terms of like having fun is to like change it up, because with the different characters you know the appearance kind of comes with it, you know. And that's it's a real kind of challenging thing. But yeah, no, but to like what you were saying, yeah, no, you know, if like I think, you know, all of us, if we can't get better, if we can't grow, if we can't, you know, evolve. But more importantly, if you can't learn from your mistakes, that's it's just not like a good look, like in terms of your like overall life. So when you know, I can respect, you know, grown men and women adjusting and, you know, making decisions for what's best for your life.
Yeah.
So, you know, I respect that. So, you know, yeah, who am I to say anything, you know, to like anyone who wants to, you know, live their best possible life? And, you know, big decisions come with that. But it's a good thing. And it's what I like, what like I can appreciate and respect about you is that you could have sat around talking about it or you could have done it. And you leading by example is I think what has made you successful with, you know, with how you live your life as we speak. So,
yeah. I mean, even that time when I showed up on set, I'm a Christian guy. I'm not, you know, the dirty jokes. I'm not into all that or nothing. But I remember showing up and wanting to show, like, listen, I'm still David. I'm still me. You guys are still my friends. You know what I mean? And I don't know. I just felt it important to solidify that, you know, and we have been friends ever since. And I do want to ask, man, that one movie clip, there's a scene where you're in a tank top with braids. What was that? Was that a short film or was that a film or did it release or?
It was a short film that was, it was like incomplete. Okay. So the people who I was working with, they had a plan and in the attempt to like execute, they kind of stumbled around and I kind of like hung in there. And then eventually it was never completed where like it could be put out. It's on YouTube somewhere.
Okay.
But like it's still like incomplete. So what I had to do was like track down my footage and then kind of like re-edit it and, you know, make it presentable where I can like, you know, at least put it on a reel.
Cause I don't know what about it, man. There's just a cool, the way that's walking, the way the camera's following you. It's amazing, right?
Yeah, it was like different scenes, but yeah. It wasn't like a complete beginning, middle, and end. It was just moments.
Yeah.
You know, and like what was done is, you know, like I got it on my like all the scenes are on my IG somewhere too, but
yeah,
it's just, you know, a bunch of like scenes out of order that like look great, but in terms of like a completed story.
Yeah.
You know, so
yeah. So then that movie came out, The Deliverance of Evil. You play a husband and a wife with Angel Aviles, and there's some creepy stuff going on in the house, and then that came out. And I remember I watched that and a couple other ones of the Quiroz Pumpkin Patch picture films. But then you continue to do stuff, and this is why I say that you're the hardest working, underrated Latino actor, because the fact that you're willing to change your appearance, you're not the same typecast cholo gangbanger guy. You can do that role, but then, you know, you never know your hairstyle, your facial hair, your body weight. You know, there's times where you're just heavier and then you're thinned out. I'm just like, this guy has got to be the hardest working. Is that all on purpose?
Yeah, I got to say first with like Jose and Ed, because when you went away, I thought I was done too. I thought, oh, you know, like they'll, you know, keep it pushing and like move on. But fortunately, a lot of the opportunities I got with Jose and Ed to continue, because it was like drug dealer, crooked cop, and then it was like you know, pothead, mercenary, vampire, serial killer, you know.
Oh, Stamford Psycho, that's right.
Yeah, you know, just like all these, you know, things where like I would like shave my head or I would like comb it a certain way for like five on it too. I wanted to like lose weight to like look younger or something.
Yeah.
And then, you know, even with like Bay Slang and stuff like that, you know, cause like Jose and Ed are like very specific with their dialogue. So like I owe them a ton for allowing me to like hang in there, but you know but like I still earned it, you know. I worked hard, I was prepared, and I feel like, you know, I brought it like every time. But it was like, you know, being in like, you know, film school working,
yeah,
it was very like hands-on. So between their stuff and the stuff that I was doing in like Arizona, and then, you know, coming to LA, it was a lot of opportunity to gain weight, lose weight, you know, facial hair, you know, mustache, goatee, beard, clean shaven, long hair, short. You know, I dye my hair all kinds of, you know, different colors. You know, I you know, shave my head every once in a while. So yeah, it's, you know, wearing, you know, glasses and hats, all these like little things that just add to a character where I want to keep it fresh.
I mean, some movies you're just all buffed out like a weightlifter.
Yeah. I mean, I've always been a gym rat, but the thing that I learned early on in like Arizona with like being a big guy is that you could get typecast.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I'm going to be the, you know, the bodyguard, you know, guy forever if I allow it. And,
yeah.
You know, I started to write and produce and even like direct short films to create opportunities for myself where I would cover myself up. Yeah. And it wasn't, you know, like about physique. It was about performance and like, you know, and to like, you know, show range, you know, do like comedy and do like silly stuff and not like have to be like super intense or like dramatic all the time. So it, like, it's about showing range, but being big can like help me, but like, it could also like get in the way. So I would have to like find ways to like cover it up, lose weight, you know, or use it to my advantage as well. So
you're like, yeah, I can't show my six pack. I can't.
Hey man, I don't, you know, I grew up on, you know, Schwarzenegger and Stallone running through the jungles with their shirt off with, you know, machine guns and stuff. But like, I don't want to do that stuff. You know what I mean? you know, it's like, I can like appreciate the whole like action star thing, but like, I never wanted to be like an action star. I just want to be like, like an actor with good material, you know?
So I come out, you're doing that movie. And then I believe that I got on 2010. And then I believe for 4 years, I just kind of talked to you through Facebook and whatnot. Or 2013, I approached you and I said, hey, I'm ready to jump back into film. I want to do a faith-based Christian movie called Always With You. Yeah. And I wasn't sure how you were going to answer because, again, you know, some people, man, they get blackballed when they do faith-based films, man. And you're just like, let's do it. You know, and that was so awesome, man, that you played the father in the movie Always With You with ALG and actually with my daughter.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
I did like a few faith-based films in Arizona, feature films, you know, and
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and they were great characters. Yeah. And you know, I don't, you know, like, again, it's, you know, like, you know, any type of coming of age story that has a positive, you know, message is good.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't, you know, like, it's faith-based, but it's still a movie like any other film.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, even like after all those years with like staying in touch, you know, I gotta be honest, I was a fan of yours back in the day. So, you know, it's not Dino, it's David, but David's still asking me to be in his like you know, your like debut as a you know, filmmaker director. I was honored. I was like, man, absolutely. That's kind of cool to me. Like, like I still have the little bit of like geeking out inside. Like, oh man, like I'm gonna be in his film. You know what I mean? So,
yeah. And there's more coming. I know we were planning on doing a movie. I put pause on it. I know I haven't talked to you about it. Actually, I'm doing a documentary right now on my wife's brother. He's doing 25 years in federal prison and. Oh man, his story is phenomenal. And I'm doing a documentary on that. So that's why I put a pause on that movie I was talking to you about. But yeah, man. Well,
I remember that book.
Yeah.
Because you gave me, like, I was at your house and you gave me a copy of it. So I remember that book. And, you know, screenplay wise, I think like eventually when you do it, it'll be like a really good.
Yeah. He's talking about Mist of My Confusion, guys. It's a book that I wrote before I went to prison. I was not a Christian, but I still want to do that film because it's still a lesson. It's still a powerful story that I think is it's encouraging, because I still think it's a positive outlook, regardless of it being written even prior to that. And that's why I wanted to, I still have a want to write and direct it and actually film it, you know. And of course I told Jose, man, you got to be in it, you know what I mean? So that's going to be awesome. So I kind of want to jump forward to the last movie I've seen of yours is Monsters of Man.
Dude,
that one, like, out of everything you have done, that blew my mind. That movie was amazing. You weren't some little part on the side. I mean, you were up front. Your character was strong. The quality of the movie was amazing. I don't know how that movie did, because it was in the middle of COVID. You know, mm-hmm. I think that hurt it, but nevertheless, I think a lot of people saw it. If they haven't seen it, I don't know what they're waiting for, you know. But I think that had it not been through COVID, that would have been even bigger. I don't know what your thoughts are on that.
Yeah, Monsters of Man was like a one-of-a-kind, like top three, like highlight of my entire career. You know, I met a director. His name is Mark Toya. He's from Australia. And I auditioned my ass off. And I got the role, and I went to Cambodia for a month. And a lot of the story takes place in the jungles of Cambodia. It's, you know, it's very sci-fi. It's about robots. And the experience, like, that's why I wake up every day and say, man, I get to act today. Like, yeah, you know, and that experience was like a next level highlight that paid off. And I love that film. I love that film.
Me too.
Awesome character.
I purchased it. You know, I was like, I'm not renting this, I'm purchasing this.
I appreciate that. Yeah, no, it was. And then, yeah, you know, 2020, just, you know, as you know, I don't have to like explain, you know, like yeah. It happened, right? Like all that stuff happened. And I think if it wasn't for that, because, you know, even now we're just back, you know, coming around with like theaters and stuff. I think it would have had like a bigger release in terms yes. of like theaters and stuff like that. That was the like yeah. actual plan. And then you know, like a lot of the big films started going to like, you know, VOD and just yeah. being available on these different platforms. And now that's become like a normal thing. So
yeah,
we had to like go that route. And it like, you know, did well. You know, he spent, you know, like his own money on it, and he got it back. So he did, that's you good. Know, like, you know, that's like my favorite part of it. But no, I mean, it's there. It's Monsters of Man dot movie, yeah. and like, you know, it's available for free on Tubi. You know, so
yeah.
But yeah,
I purchased it on Amazon Prime.
Okay, yeah.
That way I can have it forever. That is a director that people should keep an eye on. I'll say that. I'm going to say this. That movie should have been just as big in the 80s as Predator and Terminator. It should have been just as big. And maybe it is, like I said, but I think it's just amazing, you know. But, man, I was really impressed, and I was excited for you. You know, every time you came on the scene, I'm like, I know him. And it's just me and my wife here. You know, and then another one that, is, in case somebody doesn't recognize you, is those little sub movies of The Walking Dead.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know what they're called, but
they're spin-offs of The Walking Dead show, and it's called The Walking Dead Red Machete. Red yeah. Machete, and it's a spinoff of the origin of the
machete. Of Rick Grimes, the Rick Grimes
yeah.
machete.
Yeah, with the red handle, and yeah. It's kind of like the origin of like when, like where that came from, and that was an amazing like opportunity because it was all, you know, everybody from The Walking Dead, and it aired every Sunday night on AMC with The Walking Dead, so it was cool. Like in terms of like exposure, it was a pretty big deal, and it's still on the AMC website. So yeah, that was a lot of fun, a lot of great exposure on that.
Dude, that was awesome. I'm telling you, man, I'm one of your biggest fans. So anytime when I saw that, I freaked out. I'm like, yes, you know what I mean? And I'm just so happy for you. You know, I always pray for you, man. I'm not saying like I wake up every day and Jose pops in my head, but I'm saying when I see when I see your posts and I see things you're doing, I'm just like, Lord, you know, just protect him and just watch over him, you know, and things like
appreciate that.
I remember that. When you were in Thailand, I was seeing your Facebook posts as you were filming that movie. You know what I mean? And it's just a great experience to follow. And I think I've been hoarding you to myself. I think the world out there needs to know about you. And that's kind of why I really wanted to do this video, man, because you work hard for what you do. I see the work that you do, and people should just be impressed, man, because I like what you're doing. I like the fact that you have stayed humble. You're still the same guy that I remember, you know, back then, you know, and I love that about you, you know what I mean? And it's just really cool. Is there anything you're working on right now that you want to share?
Yeah, I did a film. It's like a psychological thriller that we wrapped March 16th of 2020. So that was right before like everything happened. So, yeah. And it's finally coming out. And I heard last night that it's available October 4th. Okay. So in the next couple of weeks, I'll be posting the trailer when it comes out, and I'll be promoting it like crazy. There's actually a convention here in Los Angeles, October 1st and 2nd, and I'm gonna attend to help promote the film. It's called Hotel Dunsmuir, and. Question: Are you familiar with Dunsmuir?
No,
it's a small town, up north past the Bay Area.
Oh, I don't know nothing about it.
Yeah, so like I spent some time up there right before the pandemic happened. Super small town, but like it was a great experience. And so it's called Hotel Dunsmuir. It comes out October 4th, and I'm excited about that. So it's like a psychological thriller and. You know, some like creepy stuff. So that's cool. And then I got to tell you, man, I did this thing with Comedy Central, and it's like the official like Comedy Central stamp on it. Yeah. And when you see this, you're going to go, what did I just watch? But why am I laughing? And why do I want to watch it again? That's all I'm going to say, because.
Okay.
When you see it, you're going to go, oh, man. You're going to go, oh, man. But I just want to warn you, it'll come out like later in the year. But when you see it, you'll know what I'm talking about. But I'm probably excited like about that.
Yeah.
More than anything, because it's just, yeah.
Wow.
Comedy Central, funny stuff. I like the like. Goofy, silly stuff,
yeah.
More than like anything. So yeah, those two things. I did a film in Norway that's like a teenage romance comedy, and I was hoping that it would have a 2022 release, and like it like still might, you know. So you know, for like anyone who like follows my like IG or my Facebook, I promote like crazy. So when yeah. when that like when those pieces of like information come along, I plaster it like everywhere, you know. So
and what is your Instagram? What is your how can people follow you?
Yeah, so my Facebook is Jose Grossette, one word, and my Instagram is at actor Jose Grossette. And JoseGrossette.net is where my reel is, all my voiceover work, my commercials, and my social media is on there as well.
Okay. That's awesome, man. I just, man, maybe later on, I have a feeling people are going to say, man, how can I get into acting or this and that? I think that's a whole other conversation. But I wanted to give people an overview of who you are, some of the work you've done. Because if we talked about all the work you've done, we'd be here for hours and hours and hours, you know. I think this is a great introduction, and it's always good to see you. I know that I know when I go on Tony A's show, you listen to it. Did you get to watch the American Cholo when I did? After all,
I did, and like since then, I've. Become you know, like a viewer of like his content now. So
yeah. So I don't know what they're sleeping on, man, because American Cholo, Tony A, you guys gotta get a hold of Jose.
You know what, man? I watch those shows all the time. I don't consider myself a good interview, man. Like my like anxiety, you know, kicks in, and I wanna like express myself, and I want to like, you know, talk, and I've seen buddies of mine on those on that show, so it's yeah. it's great, but it's still like,
yeah,
you know, it's, you know, but yeah,
you think is it easier because we know each other?
I think so. I think in terms of the conversation and not the question answer, you know what I mean?
It's, because there's background with us, so it's easier.
Yeah. And I've, you know, like, it's weird how if we don't see each other or talk, when we do, we just pick up where we left off. You know what I mean? So that's like, it's a comfort thing for me. So.
Yeah, no, that's cool, man. That's cool. You know, I separated a channel because I used to put all of my sermons, Bible studies, devotionals, and then I'll throw interviews in there. And I kind of said, you know what, I want to keep the church where if people go to that channel, they're going to see Bible studies, devotional sermons. But I also wanted to have this David Rocha channel where I'm talking to different people. I like cycling now. I don't know if you know that.
I
like riding my bike.
And you paint.
Yes. I learned how to paint in prison. So I want to kind of expand and show a little bit more of myself on that. And that's where this video is going to be on.
As you should, man. As you should.
Yeah. You know, and I just thought, you know what? I want to talk to Jose, you know what I mean? And I don't think anybody ever has to this extent that I know of, you know, and it's a privilege, you know, it's a privilege. Next week, I'm going to be talking to Wilson Ramirez.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Great dude, man. Like super passionate, like he's like the craft of like acting, like, you know what I'm saying? Like he, like I like people who remind me of me, because like right away I'm like, I want to be friends, you know what I'm saying? Because it's just when you take this like super serious, it's you know, it's good to like, you know, he's someone that like I root for, you know what I mean? I'm a fan of his, you know what I mean? So
yeah, in case you guys don't know who he is, he was in the Mayans for a few episodes, and he was in the Kilroy movie that that Paul directed. And but he agreed to do a Zoom next week, and I'm looking forward to that.
Good.
And yeah, man. So anyways, I'm going to let you go, bro. I just appreciate everything that you shared. Hopefully people go and you know, watch some of the films that you did and check you out. And Always With You, I took it off of YouTube because I want to get it on Amazon Prime.
Oh, good. Okay.
So I'm in the middle of doing that, but they need a closed caption file with it. There's a couple of technical things I need to do before they accept it to get it on Amazon Prime. Gotcha. So once that's up, I'll let you know, so you know.
Yeah.
But any last words you want to say to anybody watching or?
You know what? I do. I want to say I got a plug. So the, you know, www.monstersofman.movie. I think it's a really good film, especially if you're into like sci-fi and like robots and stuff. The other thing I wanted to say is, you know, I respect you a lot, and I think the reason why you're like going as strong as you are is because I think Sir Dino was a leader, and through transition, David's a leader, and that's why you're doing what you're doing, because you don't follow, you lead. So never stop that. Don't ever stop that. And just, you know, I'm just gonna like throw this out there to everyone who's watching. We all have, you know, peaks and valleys. There's good times, and then there's some like rough times. Wherever you're at, never think that when things are going great, or if you're in the dumps and like nothing is going your way, wherever you are, even like in between, never think that you can't ask for help. Asking for help is a cool thing. It is a cool thing. So don't think that it's like uncool to like, you know, to like need some help in your life. So don't keep things inside. Like it's okay to ask for help. Yeah. And the other thing is, never think that you're too cool to tell people that you love them. You know what I'm saying? I've experienced some stuff here, like in the past week or two, that just, you know, as a cliche as it is, man, like, we're not promised tomorrow. And if you got like loved ones out there, let them know, man. Like, tell them every day, you know. And like, I'm not saying be like a pest about it, but like, I'm just saying, yeah, you know, it's, you're still going to be cool if you tell people that you have love for them, and just, you know, tell yeah. them, hey, man, you know what I'm saying? So yeah. it's kind of a, you know, don't wait until something happens to go, man, I wish I would have, you know, told them how I like felt about them, or just like appreciate them. You know what I mean? So,
and I could see in your life, you're true to that, because I constantly see you going back to Arizona to see family.
Yeah. Yeah. Man, every month it's, you know, and this is my, you know, favorite time of year, because now like Halloween's around the corner, Thanksgiving's around the corner, Christmas, where that's like all about family right there. So,
yeah. So much love to you. Much love to all of your family in Chandler.
And likewise, man.
Else, man. And, I just want to thank you, man, for this.
You're very welcome, bro. And anytime, if you ever like, you know, ever like want to do something like this again, and I'm looking forward to like shooting that film with you as well.
Yeah.